Question 11. A trader did not keep full accounting records. The following information was available for 2015. Here, trade payables on 1st January, which is the opening trade payables, and then trade payables on 31st December, and which is the closing trade payables. Then payments to suppliers during the year and discount received during the year. So all the informations are related to the trade payables, that means credit suppliers. And the requirement is, what was the value of purchase? That means we have to calculate the value of purchase, and we can calculate the value of purchase using different methods. But we have to follow the given information. As the all information relates to the suppliers, we have to prepare, so we can prepare trade payables TA account to calculate value of purchase. But we can also use an easy formula, and that is payment to credit suppliers plus discount receipt plus closing balance equals to opening balance plus purchase. And we have got all this information from the trade payables T account. The items of the left side we have got from the debit side, and the right side item we have got from the credit side. Although here is credit purchase, but we have to prepare value of purchase, that means the total amount of credit purchase and cash purchase. So by entering the value of all the items, we can simplify this equation. Here, payment to suppliers is 72,830. Then discount received, and here is discount received during the year 3,450. That is here, and then closing balance 43,630. And here is trade payables on 31st December 43,630. We have recorded here, and then opening balance. So trade payables on 1st January, which is the opening balance, and that is 32,785. And we have recorded here. And the purchase we is the subject, that means we have to calculate the value of purchase. Then by simplifying, we have got the value of purchase, and that is 87,125. And this is our answer, and our answer is represented by option D. Question 12. A partnership admits a new partner. The requirement is, which statement is correct? Option A. Profits will always be shared equally following the new partner's admission. This is incorrect because the profit and loss ratio is not fixed. It may be any ratio agreed between partners later. Option B. The new partners will always benefit if assets are later revalued upwards. This is correct because revalued upwards means a profit on revaluation. So after admission, the new partners will get a share of benefits. Option C. The new partner must always contribute capital to the partnership. This is incorrect because capital is given only upon admission, not always. On the other hand, sometimes partners may not pay capital. Partner can only work for the business. Therefore, the partner can gain some partnership ratio. That means profit or loss ratio. Option D, the new partner will always pay for a share of partnership goodwill. This is also incorrect because goodwill is not always retained in the books of account of partnership. So the partner, that means the new partner, may not pay the partnership goodwill always. So our answer is represented by option B. Question 13. X, Y, and Z are in partnership sharing the profit and losses in the ratio of 2x2, 2x2, 1. Then, at 31st December, the following information is available. Here, capital account balance current account balances. And then on 31st December, debt retires from the partnership. The total assets are revalued upward by 45,000 and there is no goodwill. So how much will debt be paid on his retirement? So dear student, we have to calculate the balance of debt. So dear student, we have to calculate the balance that debt will be received on his retirement. So firstly, we have to calculate the net balance of debt from the capital account and the current account balance. And here is the net balances of debt accounts from the capital accounts of 50,000 minus current account balance is 5,000 and which is 45,000. And here, the total assets are revalued upward by 45,000. So according to the partnership ratio, debt has the entitled on the revaluation reserve of the asset. And debt share of profit on revaluation is 45,000 multiply 1 divided 5. And this is the proportion of the ratio. So debt shares on revaluation is 9,000. So the total amount debt will be paid equals to 45,000, which is net balance of debt's account, and 9,000, which is the debt shares on revaluation. So the total amount is 54,000, and which is our answer. And our answer is represented by option A. Question 14. The following information relates to partnership. And here, profit from operation, loan interest, interest on drawings, interest on capital. And the requirement is, what is the residual profit to be appropriated amongst the partners? So we have to calculate residual profit from the appropriation account of the partnership business. And the appropriation account contains a profit for the year. Here, profit for the year equals to 90,000 minus 3,200 equals to 86,800, where 90,000 is the profit from operation, and loan interest 3,200, which is deducted from operating profit to calculate net profit for the year, because loan interest should be deducted in the profit and loss account in the income statement, not in the appropriation account. Appropriation account opens with the net profit for the year. Then, income and expense related to the partners will be adjusted to the net profit in the appropriation account. And here, interest on drawings, which is an income related to the partners, to the partnership business. So, this item is added with the profit in the appropriation account. And here, the addition of interest on drawings, 6,000. And then, drawings, which is the item of current account, not appropriation account. So we should avoid drawings of 40,000 to adjust in the appropriation account. And finally, interest on drawings, this is an expense. So this item should be deducted from the profit in the appropriation account. And here is the deduction of interest on capital, which is expense, and that is 11,000. So finally, we can get the residual profit is 81,800, and which is our ultimate answer. And our answer is represented by option C. Question 15. A partnership earned an average profit during the year of 15,000 per month. And halfway through the year, D and E were joined by new partner F, and profits were shared equally before and after the 10th. So here, D and E were partners in the first half of the year, and after that, D and E and F were the partnership in the second half. And in the second half, the partnership ratio also equal. So the ratio for old partner is 1:1 and for new partnership 1:1:1. Then, in the first half of the year, D transferred his private vehicle to the partnership at the valuation of 12,000. D's drawing amounted to 60,000 during the year. And the requirement is, what was the increase in the D's current account balance during the year? So, dear student, we have to calculate increase in D's current account balance during the year. So, we have to adjust the given adjustment to the calculation of current account balance. So, firstly, we have to calculate the profit because here average profit during the year is given 15,000 per month, but we need profit for the year and then profit, then half year. So, profit for the year equals to 15,000 per month multiply 12 months equals to 180,000. And for the halfway through the year, we need to calculate profit for the half year, and that is 180,000 divided 2 because of half year equals to 90,000. Now we can calculate the current year's account balance, and the calculation is over here where D's share of the profit before F admission, that means before first half, equals to 90,000 multiply 1 divided 2 because the old ratio was 1 is to 1, where D has the entitled of 1. So the profit is 45,000. And also, D has the share of profit after F admission equals to 90,000 multiply 1 divided 3 because the new ratio also equally 1 is to 1 is to 1. And here also, D have, and here D also had the ratio of 1. So the D's profit after the F admission is 30,000. Then we need to adjust the given two adjustment. One of them is the investment valuation of 1200 for the private vehicles transferred to the business, but the valuation of the vehicle is the part of the capital account. So the value of the 12,000 of vehicle will be recorded in the capital account, not recorded in the current account. So this 12,000 is not our part. We should avoid this. Then these drawings amounting to 60,000. So D had withdraw 60,000 from the partnership business. So we have to deduct this 60,000 from the calculations. So this drawing for the year 60,000 has been deducted. And then the net increase in the current account balance equals to 15,000, and which is our answer? And our answer is represented by option A. Question 16. How would a transfer to the general reserve and the issue of shares at a premium affect the revenue reserves of a limited company? Here, transfer to general reserve in decrease, no effect, no effect, and issue of shares at a premium decrease, increase, and no effect. And this the effect on the revenue reserve. But we know transfer to the revenue reserve is occur from the retained earnings, which is the revenue reserve. But issue of the shares at a premium, which is the share premium, and which is capital reserve. Let's see from the example. And here, capital reserves is share premium, revaluation reserves, capital redemption reserves, and revenue reserves are retained earnings and general reserves. So transfer to the general reserve from the retained earnings, the effect is general reserve is increases where retained earnings decreases. So for increasing and decreasing in the same reserve, that means in the revenue reserve at the same amount, ultimately they will be canceled out and there is no effect on the revenue reserve. And issue of share at the premium, which is share premium. So share premium increases in the capital reserve, and capital reserves has no effect on the revenue reserve. So there is no effect of issue of share at the premium price. So ultimately, there is no effect on the revenue reserve for transfer to general reserve and issue of shares at a premium. So ultimately, there is no effect on the revenue reserve. So our answer is D. Question 17. A company is formed with the issue of 100,000 6% non-cumulative preference shares of $1 each and 300,000 ordinary shares of $1 each issued at a premium of $0.20. Here, 100,000 is the number of preference shares and 6%, which is rate of dividend, and $1, this is the face value or nominal value or par value. And here, 300,000, which is the number of ordinary shares, and $1 is the face value, and 0.20, this is the premium price. So the selling price or the market value of the ordinary shares is 1.20. Then it earned profits of 3,000, 16,000, and 31,000 in the first 3 years of trading. Then the directors wish to pay an ordinary dividend of 5% each year when possible. Dear student, you know, ordinary dividend is paid on the share capital. So here share capital, we can calculate 300,000 shares multiply $1. And the requirement is, what is the value of ordinary dividend does the company actually pay in years 2 and 3? And here is the option of the answer. So dear student, we have to calculate the value of ordinary dividend for the year 2 and 3. But you have to understand, the preference share is paid first, then ordinary share dividend is paid. So firstly, we have to calculate the dividend of cumulative preference shares. And you know, in non-cumulative preference shares, shareholder receives a fixed percentage of dividend, but any omitted dividend or unpaid dividend are not carried forward to the next year. So now we have to calculate the dividend of non-cumulative preference shares, and here the dividend is 100,000 multiply $1 multiply 6% equals to 6,000, and the ordinary dividend equals to 300,000 multiply $1 multiply 5%. So the ordinary dividend equals to 15,000. And here the profit for the second year is 16,000 and 31,000 is for 3 years. And the calculation of the dividend over here, where profit for the year 16,000 in year 2 and 31,000 in year 3. Firstly, we have to deduct preference shares from the 2 years. The preference share dividend is 6,000 minus 6,000 because preference share is paid before ordinary dividend. So after paying the preference dividend, the remaining profit equals to 10,000 in the second year and 25,000 in the second year. But ordinary dividend is 15,000 each year, but in year 2, here is only profit is 10,000. So the company is able to pay only 10,000 in year 2, and in year 3, the company can pay it fully 15,000 because here is 25,000 profit is remaining. So ordinary dividend in year 2 is 10,000 and in year 3 is 15,000. And this is our answer, and our answer is represented by option C. Question 18. A company had an issued share capital of 400,000 ordinary shares of $1 each. It then made a bonus issue of one share for every 5 held. That means the ordinary shareholder have received one bonus share for holding 5 ordinary shares. And then This was later followed by a rights issue of 1 shares for every 3 held. That means the ordinary shareholders have received 1 shares, that means 1 rights share for holding every 3 ordinary shares. And the requirement is, what was the balance on the share capital account after this transaction? So, dear student, we have to calculate the share capital balance issuing bonus shares and right shares. So firstly, we have to calculate the number of shares. Here, the number of bonus shares equals to 400,000, which is the total number of ordinary shares, multiply 1 divided by 5. Here, 1 is a bonus share offered, and number 5 is the ordinary share held by the shareholders. So the number of bonus shares equals to 80,000. And after issuing bonus share, the total number of share is 480,000. And the right share have been offered based on 480,000 ordinary shares. So the number of right shares equals to 480,000 multiply 1 divided 3. Here 1 is issued right share and 3 is the number of holding ordinary shares. So number of right shares equals to 160,000. So, dear student, we have to calculate the value of ordinary shares and bonus shares and the right shares. The calculation is shown below. Here is the opening share capital is 4,000 ordinary shares multiply 1 nominal value. So, opening share capital equals to $400,000. So, now we need to calculate the share capital from the bonus issue. And the share capital bonus issue's calculation is 80,000, which is the number of the bonus issue, and multiply $1. This $1 is the nominal value of the ordinary shares. You know, bonus issue usually are valued with the nominal value of ordinary shares. So the share capital from bonus issue equals to $80,000. And the share capital from the rights issue equals to 160,000, which is the total number of rights issue, multiply $1. Here, you know, rights issue are normally valued with the given price, but there is no given price for the rights issue. Therefore, rights issue are normally valued with the nominal value of the ordinary shares if there is no value of the rights shares is given. So the share capital from the rights issue is 160,000. So the closing balance of share capital equals to 640,000, which is our answer, and our answer is represented by option D. Question 19. Which action will increase the equity of a limited company? You know, increase the equity means increase the share capital, and equity will be increased when share is issued. So let's see the answer. Option A, creating a general reserve. This is incorrect because creating general reserve will increase the reserves and reduce the retained earnings. There is no effect on the equity. Then option B, issuing bonus shares. This is also incorrect because bonus share does not increase the equity value. It only increases the number of shares because no additional capital is received, and bonus share is given from the reserves. So for bonus issue, reserve is decreased. Option C, issuing debentures. This also incorrect because debentures are the form of loan to a company. It will increase the non-current liability, not increase equity. Option D, issuing non-redeemable preference shares. This is correct answer because here preference share is issued. Preference shares will increase the value of equity because it brings additional capital to the business. So ultimately, our answer is D. Question 20. Which action leaves the value of working capital untensed? Here, action leaves the value of the working capital untensed means we have to identify the options for which the working capital will not be tensed, or the value of the working capital will not be affected. So firstly, you have to understand what the meant or what is the formula of working capital. Here, working capital equals to current asset minus current liabilities. And any transaction that affect current asset or and current liability will not be the answer. So our answer will be the options for which working capital will not be affected. So let's see the options. Option A, disposal of non-current asset. This is incorrect because disposal will reduce the non-current asset and increase the current asset due to the cash or bank received. That means when you dispose some non-current asset, you will receive some value of the non-current asset by cash or by check. That means your current asset of bank or cash will be increased, which will affect the increasing in current asset. Ultimately, working capital will be affected. So this will not our answer. Option B, issuing shares for cash. This is also incorrect because this item will increase the equity and increase the current asset due to the cash or bank receipt. Same explanation here. Issuing share for cash will increase the amount of cash. That means the increase in current asset, which will affect working capital. So this is not our answer. Then option C, purchasing goods for resale on credit. This is correct answer because here this item will increase the current asset for purchasing goods. This is inventory, and you know inventory is the current asset because inventory will be more and also increase the current liability because accounts payable will be more. Here current liability will be increased because the purchasing goods on credit. So there is no effect as current asset and current liability both will be increased in the same amount. So there is no effect on the working capital. Therefore, option C is our answer. And finally, option D, written off an irrecoverable debt. This is also incorrect because this item will decrease the current asset because irrecoverable debt is deducted from the accounts receivable. And you know, account receivable is a current asset. So for irrecoverable debt, account receivable, that means current asset is decreased. So working capital is affected for written off an irrecoverable debt. So we have got our answer is option C. Dear students, I believe that you have understood clearly all the solutions in this part. So for more solutions, click on the link given below in the description box and visit our website for a full course.